But God doesn't look at the first birth. He looks at the second birth. Ah, that's why he says you must be born again. Oh, Lord. He keeps on giving. Thank you, Jesus. It's not because of me, but great is your faithfulness toward me. And God took me from junk. I said, God took me from junk and put me in the front seat so that I can sit together in heavenly places. See, when you come to Jesus, there is rejoicing in heaven. You think it's only the angels that get excited? God. Oh, he's coming back home. He crossed it. The Bible says he became sin who knew no sin, that we may become his righteousness.
Pleasant Sabbath to you all, and I really enjoyed being here in Jamaica. After tomorrow, we'll be taking on a tour throughout your beautiful island, and my driver today, Elder Walker, told me that he's going to take me to Tivoli Gardens. Somebody pray for that guy. Pray for him. I have already done pray for him. Father, forgive him, for he knows not what he says. But I'm in the hands of the president, thank God, and he'll be my driver, I presume, from Sunday. And Elder Walker will take me back to the airport after such. But he has been a good soldier, and I thank God for him and his wife, and I thank God for the company that we have been able to keep. We have shared so much in a few days that we have been together, and he's a good man, he's a good soul, and I thank God for you, my dear brother. This evening, and it came upon me last evening, because I hardly go to a place and speak without making a special appeal. I never dare take any congregation for granted, because I believe God is always in the business of saving people. So this camp meeting, as far as I'm concerned, was not and is not meant to be an exhibition of preaching, but a demonstration of the Spirit's power. And my feeling is that there are some people who are desirous of surrendering their lives to Jesus Christ. So I would make a bold appeal at the end of this sermon. If you don't want to respond, you can leave now. No, I don't really mean that, but I'm going to make an appeal. I'm not sure how the Lord will move this evening, and I'm going to be making that special appeal for you to surrender. Perhaps there's somebody who has never surrender their all to Christ. And that is the appeal I'm going to be making in a special way. God did not just put his boundless grace on display, but his grace is to save us from sin. As while we sit up, we want to welcome all of those of you who are streaming live. We understand that we are live via the internet, so this is going all over the world. And we thank you for choosing this airwaves for your blessing. This evening, I propose to go to a very, perhaps, an unfamiliar passage. Nonetheless, for those who are astute Bible students, it's one that I'm sure we would be quite familiar with. It's found in the book of 2 Samuel, chapter 9. 2 Samuel, chapter 9. I would want to read in your hearing from verse 1. Second Samuel, chapter 9. Perhaps you can read with me responsively. I'll read the first verse, you read the second, and we will proceed accordingly until perhaps verse 11. And David said, "Is there yet any that is left of the house of Saul that I may show him kindness for Jonathan's sake?" And the king said, "Is there not yet any of the house of Saul that I may show the kindness of God unto him?" And Ziba said unto the king, "Jonathan bath yet a son, which is lame," perhaps birth is the word, "which is lame on his feet." Then King David sent and fetched him out of the house of Machir, the son of Amiel from Lodabar. And he answered. And David said unto him, "Fear not, for I will surely show thee kindness for Jonathan thy father's sake, and will restore thee all the land of Saul thy father, and thou shalt eat bread at my table continually." Then the king called Ziba, Saul's servant, and said unto him, "I have given unto thy master's son all that pertain to Saul and to all his house." Then said Ziba unto the king, "According to all that my lord the king hath commanded his servant, so shall thy servant do. As for Mephibosheth," said the king, "he shall eat at my table as one of the king's sons." Had a young son whose name was Micah, and all that dwell in the house of Ziba were servants unto Mephibosheth. The last verse. So Mephibosheth dwelt in Jerusalem, for he did eat continually at the king's table and was lame on both his feet. And Mephibosheth did eat continually at the king's table. The message for the next few moments is simply captioned, "You may be seated." You may be seated. Let us pray. Now, Lord, on this, your blessed Sabbath evening, we await a word that will speak to needs and to situations that we know not of, but that you know so well. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts once again be acceptable in thy sight. Speak, Lord, for we, your servants, are listening. Amen. As I begin the message, I want to take your attention once again to the same book, but this time chapter 4, to give what we want to talk about a little context. 2 Samuel. I take the time to read the scriptures because very often we walk with the Bible and don't open the Bible. So it's good to spend time looking at what the Bible says, because at the end of the presentation, you must hear not what I have said, but what God has said. My purpose is not for you to hear the commands of God, but for you to hear God commanding. And so we're going to look at just verse 4, 2 Samuel chapter 4, verse 4. "And Jonathan, Saul's son, had a son that was lame of his feet. He was 5 years old when the tidings came of Saul and Jonathan out of Jezreel, and his nurse took him up and fled. And it came to pass, as she made haste to flee, that he fell and became lame, and his name was Mephibosheth." Now we understand what caused the lameness of this man called Mephibosheth. Saul had died by his own sword, and Jonathan perished at the hands of the Philistines. And so it would have left to become heir of the throne one guy called Ishbosheth, which was another one of Saul's son, and of course this guy called Mephibosheth. If something had gone wrong with Ishbosheth, it meant, therefore, that Mephibosheth would have been next in line as heir of the throne that was now left vacant by the death of Saul. The records have it, if you read the text, you will understand that David's men had proceeded to slay Ishbosheth, and they came back with the spoils of victory, boasting to David that we had killed him. David was upset and killed them, because David was a man after God's own heart. Though Saul did not like him, David, remember, Saul was anointed and still spared his life when he could have taken his life. He had respect for Saul, not because of Saul, but because of God. Am I talking to anybody here today? It wasn't so much of the man, but of the position that he held that caused David. David saw the day when Saul was anointed. And so he still had respect for Saul. And the Bible will have us believe that Saul fell on his own sword, which reminds me that very often the sword that we must fear the most is a sword that we wield with our own hands. It's not what people said about us that will cut us the deepest. It's what we say about ourselves that would hurt us the most. Saul fell on his own sword, and Jonathan had fallen at the hands of the Philistines. This nurse, now recognizing that the Philistines had won the battle, thought it best that if the little boy, this little five-year-old, was standing in line to become heir, I got to protect him until he gets old enough to occupy the position. And so the Bible would have us believe that she grabbed him with a sense of urgency and ran out. And in the midst of the running out, in the midst of the haste, she stumbled and the child fell out of her hand. And from that day forward, Mephibosheth became lame because somebody dropped him. I agree that there are some things, some habits that we have which we ourselves inculcate. There are some things that we do. There are some things that we have inherited because of the things that we ourselves have chosen to do. But there are some things that we have become. There are some people, there are some personalities that we have become because somebody dropped you. Stay with me, please. Because there are some things that have happened to us because it was the fault of somebody else. Perhaps it was the church that is supposed to carry you that dropped you. There are some of us who have been dropped emotionally. Some have been dropped socially. The environment in which you were born and raised has nothing to do with what you chose, but because of your parents and perhaps their own lifestyle, you were born in that environment. Perhaps you were dropped educationally because you did not get the opportunities and the benefits from education because of what happened to your parents. There are some of us who have been dropped morally. We are now living in a society where morality is becoming more extinct, and the level and the values of moral standing are becoming more and more depleted because you see, you now find a society where more and more people are committing sexual relationships outside of wedlock. So there are more people being born to individuals who are not married than those being born to those who are married. Are you following what I'm trying to say here today? And so as a result, the value system is being corroded because somebody dropped you. Somebody is showing himself irresponsible. You've got to understand that this young man inherited his crippled life because somebody who was responsible for carrying him fell. And it could be that some people are falling because you have fallen. I'm reminded of David's experience in the time when he was up against the lion and the bear. David came to the battlefield to face Goliath one day. And David told Saul, "My resume is what happened to me when the lion and the bear came along." You see, Saul, you were not around and you did not know there was a time a lion came up against the sheep. It came up against the sheep. And because I love the sheep, you don't hear what I'm saying. Because I love the sheep, I had to defend that which I love. Oh, you gotta be careful who is in charge of the sheep. Oh, are you hearing what I'm saying? You've got to be careful who is in charge of the sheep, because if David had not defended the sheep would have been in trouble. Now get this. David was fighting against the lion and the bear when nobody knew it. Why? Because there are some beasts that you must fight in your private life. There are some things you will come up against where nobody would know about it. Before you aspire to stand up before Goliath, make sure you can conquer the lion and the bear in your private life. Too many people want the public life. They want to shine, but they have not overcome the lion. And am I talking to anybody here today? Too many people want the spotlight, but David told Saul, "I am able to stand here because there are some things in my private life that I was able to overcome." I am saying to you, a fall in public is often preceded by a fall in private. People
People don't fall in public until they fall in private. But David stood up against the lion and the bear in private because he understood that if I don't stand, the sheep will fall. Oh, if you want to be a leader, you are taking a responsibility to set an example for your sheep. Am I talking to anybody? Why are you so quiet this evening? If you want to aspire to become an elder, make sure you are willing to lay down your life for the sheep, because the sheep are depending upon you to stand. If you don't stand, the sheep would be in trouble. Many people are falling because leaders are falling. Am I talking to anybody here this evening? You fall down because somebody dropped the baton. Somebody dropped the morality. Somebody dropped spiritual life. Somebody's dropping, and you've got to understand God is depending upon you to carry the sheep. But David stood up against the lion and the bear. It was there when nobody saw it. Stay with me tonight. When nobody knew it, it was there when nobody saw him. There he composed, "The Lord is my shepherd." You want the spotlight, but sometimes God's revelation comes to you when you are all alone. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. So much so that when he came up to Goliath, his elder brother said, "What you doing here?" David said, "What do you mean, what am I doing here? Is there not a cause? But you want to show off?" No, I didn't come in my name. I have already written a psalm that says, "Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil." Why? Because God is with me. You can only talk from conviction when you have an experience with the Lord. The same Lord who delivered me out of the hand of the lion and the bear is the same God who's going to deliver me from this uncircumcised Philistine. Why? Because this same guy is doing what the lion and the bear did. He is attacking the sheep. And I already got my internship from the, are you hearing what I'm saying? I've been through my internship, and I've learned that when you tackle the sheep, you tackle Jesus. And I will stand up for Jesus, regardless of who the enemy might be. So Mephibosheth was dropped because somebody was careless, dropped him. He had a deformity because somebody dropped him. He couldn't walk as he should walk because somebody dropped him. He couldn't behave as he should because the one responsible for carrying him dropped him. Oh, sometimes we drop members after we baptize them. I'm leaving next Wednesday so I can hit and run. Sometimes we drop them. We are happy you got baptized. We give them a hand of fellowship, but that's the last shake hand they will ever receive. After that, we drop them. And we have the audacity that when they go out and do what they have to do, look, he was baptized last week. Look at what he's doing. You dropped him. You caused it. I am longing for the day when each member can become responsible for those who come into the church. Don't just leave it up to the preacher. He's a member of the church. Love them to Jesus. I want to be real with you. I have a bone to pick with my church because I feel too many times we put on fig leaves. Let me take this thing off. Too many times we put on fig leaves. Oh, we know how to smile once you are an SDA.
Oh, you know what I'm talking about, right? Don't play so sanctimonious. Oh, maybe it's only in Trinidad that has happened. We know how to pretend. We know how to walk with fig leaves every Sabbath. You put on, we saw our own fig leaves and walked to church. Want everybody to know how pious and religious we are not. We haven't learned to be real. Let me tell you something. God wants real people. God can't save any pretensive individual. He wants real people. People who know how to cry. People who know how to laugh. People who know how to praise God. Ah, are you hearing what I'm saying? He wants real people. I'm mad because I used to be there. I used to hear a good sermon preached, but I knew I couldn't say amen too loud because somebody would look at you funny. Does anybody know what I am talking about today? Can't move, you can't do. I remember one day, I stood up behind a pulpit and I was speaking on the resurrection and I stood up still from start to finish. On the resurrection, talking about Lazarus, and stood up still. A guy came to me and accosted me. He said, how could you preach resurrection and be so quiet? Talking about resurrection. Let me tell you something. Some of us will get a culture shock when we go to heaven. I'm going to come to that in a little while. We'll get a culture shock. After that day, I vow I cannot talk. How can you talk about Sunday morning and act as if it's Friday evening? You gotta be kidding! He's alive! He's alive! I said he's alive! Oh, it's all right if you want to sit down with your pious self and say, hallelujah. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. That's all right if that's your personality. But please don't stop me when I start to praise God. Don't stop me. That's not how I know to praise God. I got to make a joyful noise unto the Lord. Oh. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? Gotta get excited about Jesus. Do you know who Jesus is? The miracle worker, the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star, the one who was and is to come, who always is ising because he cannot have a past and he doesn't have a future because he always is. Things are hurting you, but you don't want anybody to know. Well, Mephibosheth was lame. And the Bible says he went into a place called Lodebar, which in the Hebrew means a place of no pasture. Here was a guy of royal degree, hiding, and being comfortable. What is very amusing, I saw it just as I read today. What is very amusing as I read the text in 2 Samuel chapter 9, 2 Samuel chapter 9, verse 12 tells me, Mephibosheth, see if you see what I see. 2 Samuel 9, verse 12. And Mephibosheth had a young son. No, you didn't. Did I read it right? And Mephibosheth had a young son. No, you guys taking too long to get this. Really. Mephibosheth, who couldn't walk. Let me be a little facetious. This guy couldn't walk, but he knew how to stand. Ooh, Lord have mercy. Yes, sir. The man had a son, so not every part was lame. There's some parts that were crippled. He had a son. And the point I want to make is he had grown accustomed living in a place of no pasture, a place that was dead, that became his home. He is a man of royal degree. He had no right in Lodebar. He was supposed to be in the palace. But because he was lame, he thought he had no right to the palace. Oh, the word cripple, this thing, how much time do we have? 2 hours, okay. When I look at the word lame, I made a startling discovery, or rather, God unveiled something to me. Hear this now. The word lame in the Hebrew is the same word used for Passover. And just like you, I wonder, how could the word lame and Passover be the same word? When Jesus says the Lord's Passover, he was saying the Lord's lameness. Ah, I got your attention. Let me break it down for you. There are various nuances of the word Pascha. One of them means to hop over, or leap over, or skip over. Skip over and cripple. Skip over and cripple. Leap over and hesitate. All of these from the same word. And I asked, Lord, what are you trying to say? Let's go back to how it all began. In the time of Egypt, where they were about to be delivered from bondage, God told Moses, step aside. This is about my business. I've got to deliver my people on my own terms. So he told his people, his church, I want you to put blood on your doorposts. Remember that. And it amazed me because God already knew who were his. He already knew the members of his church. Yet he's asking them to put blood on their doorposts. I asked him, Lord, why allow them to go through that? And God told me at least two reasons why. One, they must cooperate. They must cooperate with me. You see, I will save you, but you have to cooperate to experience my salvation. The second reason is, I am not obligated to save you because you are a member. Oh, you should say, ouch. I am not obligated because your name has been on the roll how many years ago. You've got to apply the blood on the doorpost of your house. Why? Because when I am coming, I am not looking for you. I am not looking for you. You see, if I look for you and find you, I will mash you down with my judgment. But if I see the blood, I will... Oh, Lord, have mercy! I will hop over. I will hop over. You see, God is actually saying, this is the imagery. I am walking as I'm supposed to walk with my judgment upon the earth. I am walking to destroy the earth with my judgment. But if I see the blood, I become lame. I become crippled. Are you hearing me, church? So I can jump over. What Jesus is therefore saying, for you to walk out free, I have to become crippled. What do I mean? I got to cripple my judgment power. I supposed to stamp you down, but instead of stamping you down, I hesitate. Oh, Lord have mercy. I hesitate because I see the blood. It's the blood. I said the blood will cause me to skip over and to leap over and to hop over because I don't see you. I see. And somebody has told me, Pastor, you preach all the time about the blood, the blood. It's not just about the blood. They've got to perform something. They've got to do something. You know, we like that. You know, we talk about you got to show yourself obedient. True. But you misunderstand what the blood signifies. I think it was Leviticus 17:11, which says, the life of the flesh is in the...
So when Jesus is passing over the blood, when he sees the blood, he is seeing the life of his son, which tells me you no longer believe in your old life. You got to walk in newness of life. So there are some things you won't do. Are you hearing me, church? There's some things you won't do because the life of Jesus is in you. Ask any pregnant woman. Let me deviate a little bit. Ask any pregnant woman. From the time something is conceived in you, one of the signs is that you vomit. Because you see, when Jesus comes in you, there are some things which have to come out. Oh, Lord, can I get a little... Let me go on to say that a woman who is pregnant and is walking around with that air of pregnancy, the more her stomach exudes and protrudes, is the more careful she is where she walks. Why? Because she doesn't want to have a miscarriage. Yeah. So the more of Jesus you have, you got to be careful of where you walk. Yeah. There's some places you don't go anyhow. Because when Jesus is in you, the things I used to do, I will do them no more. The places I used to go, I will go there no more. The things I used to say, I will say them no more. Because Jesus is in me. So when I see the blood, I see Jesus. And I won't destroy my own son, so I will skip over. Pass over. But there's another nuance which I left for the last, which confused me altogether. It means dance. And I know this doesn't sound good in the theology of Seventh-day Adventists. But thank God I have my own theology. Dance. Remember, God says, I am your Passover. So even if you don't want to dance, when I see the blood, you see, when you come to Jesus, there is rejoicing in heaven. You think it's only the angels that get excited? God, oh, he's coming back home. He is coming back home. He is, listen to the parable of the prodigal. The Bible says it was the father who threw the party and there was music and dancing. Because you see, when God has become crippled on the cross, he became crippled so that you can walk. That's what he did. I became crippled. I hesitated. I'm supposed to come down, but I see the blood and I hesitate. It's not because you are a member. It's not because you study a Sabbath school lesson. It's not because you are an elder in the church. It's because I see the blood. I see the blood. Let me tell you something. God will save us because and only because of the blood of Jesus. Well, the Bible tells us, David said to his servant, I need to show kindness to somebody. Is there anybody left in the house of Jonathan? Why? I made a pact with Jonathan. Where do we read that? Let's go to 1 Samuel. 1 Samuel. Chapter 20. 1 Samuel. Chapter 20. I want us to read from verse 14. And thou shalt, 1 Samuel chapter 20. And thou shalt, verse 14, thou shalt not only while yet I live show me the kindness of the Lord that I die not, but also thou shalt not cut off thy kindness from my house forever. No, not when the Lord hath cut off the enemies of David, everyone from the face of the earth. So Jonathan made a covenant with the house of David, saying, let the Lord even require it at the hand of David's enemies. And Jonathan caused David to swear again because he loved him, for he loved him as he loved his own soul. They made a pact. David, even when I'm gone, I wanted to show kindness to my household. So David remembered his covenant with Jonathan and said, if there's anybody related to Jonathan, I will show kindness to him. Is there anybody? Well, there's a guy called Mephibosheth. Where does he live? Lodebar, in a place of nothingness. Go get him. And Mephibosheth, though he had stayed away from his royalty, grace. It was grace. He didn't know anything about it. He didn't even know that David was talking to Ziba. But it began and was initiated in his own heart, in David's own heart. Go and show kindness. Bring Ziba. And bring him. So grace did three things. Grace went and fetched him. I said grace went and fetched him. No. I said grace went and fetched him. You didn't come to that tent by mistake. Grace came and fetched you. You didn't come to the Lord by chance. It was grace that fetched you. Come on, somebody. You didn't get baptized by chance. It was grace that came and fetched you. I told some people a long time ago, I know it's God's grace that has me here today. It was one day I was dancing. Yes, I wasn't always a Christian. I didn't grow up in the church, and I used to go a lot of parties. There was a night I went to three parties, one after the other. But grace, come on. Can I talk to you about God's grace? While I was dancing, God spoke to me, and I just stopped on the dance floor. I was attending the church then, and I was told that angels who are accompanying you do not go to certain places that you venture into. Have you ever heard that? And maybe that is true, but I believe that day God himself came down and told the angels, excuse me, my son is inside there. I got to go and talk to him. And God came right there while I was on the dance floor, and I just stopped. And I didn't just stop then, I have stopped since then. But let me tell you something. While God came in that party and stopped me on the dance floor, he did not stop me from dancing. He just changed the music. Oh, hallelujah. He just changed the music. And so I am now dancing for Jesus. Fetched me out of that party and brought me here. Second thing grace did, grace found him. Fetched him. Found him. Come. Let's imagine for a while. This guy is lame. Even if David had sent to him instructions as to how he would get to the palace, he still couldn't come. Because you can't find Jesus. You can't come to him on your own. You're not so smart. You're not so intelligent. Huh? I don't care how bright you think you are. None of us will desire Jesus naturally, because the carnal mind is enmity against God. But grace found me. Grace found me. Oh, the height of Jesus' love, higher than the heavens above, deeper than the deepest sea, lasting as eternity. Love that found me, wondrous thought, found me when I sought him. Grace.
And then finally, David told him to sit down, and you shall eat continually all the days of your life. In fact, I'm going to treat you as a king's son all the days of your life.
This guy was in a place of nothingness. Grace found him, and grace fetched him, and grace fed him. You didn't hear what I said. Grace found him, and grace fetched him, and grace fed him all the days of his life. He was living in a state of poverty, but grace raised him up. He was living in a place of nothing, but God made him something. Oh, and God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he hath loved us, even when we were dead in trespasses and sins, he, grace, has quickened us together with him. For by grace are you saved, and has raised us up and made us sit. Come on, talk to somebody. Make us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. It's grace. Cause me to sit there in heavenly places. That's what grace does. This guy had no legs. Couldn't walk. But I'll tell you something. When he was sitting, nobody knew he was lame. You taking too long to get this. When he was sitting, everybody forgot he was lame. That's what God does. He moves you from a place of what people call you to a place where you can now say, I used to be lame. I used to be there, but now I'm sitting together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Some years ago, I was cleaning out some of the stuff in my house, which my wife would have termed junk. You know, women have a thing that if you're not using it, it's junk. But they don't understand that we men are creative. All the men say, yes, 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 yes. Very creative. So I finally decided that they have spent their time where they were, and now it's time to move on because there was time to move something else in. So I put all the junk into a box and put it out by the road. Now, we in Trinidad have sophisticated scavenger collectors or sanitation engineers, if you please. They don't collect everything you put out. They have become very sophisticated. They examine the rubbish. Can you believe it? They examine the rubbish to see if it's fit for rubbish. So I placed the box, covered it neatly, and make it look as if it was fit. And the truck was coming down. So I turned the curtain and looked out surreptitiously to see what they would do. The guy came out, watched the box. He went around it and looked inside. I said, okay, he's not going to take it. And he, reluctantly, he lifted it up. I said, okay, it's gone. But then he went around the side of the truck. Somebody was there. Went around the side of the truck. And I said, what is he going to do? And then he opened the front seat. And he put the junk in the front seat. The thing that I call junk was valuable to him. Are you hearing what I'm saying? The thing I discarded, he said, I can use this. He didn't put it in the back. He put it in the front seat. And I remember that I was junk. And God took me from junk. I said, God took me from junk and put me in the front seat so that I can sit together in heavenly places. And I don't care what my enemies said I am or said I used to be. Why? Because David says he prepares a table before me in the presence. Ah, hallelujah. In the presence of my enemy, you can say what you want to say. He still feeds me. You can do what you want to do. He still takes care of me. He prepares a table before me in the presence. Oh! Give God a hand of praise. As God is a good God. Woo. put it in the front seat. Which tells me that God likes junk. And if you don't believe me, look in the mirror. The guy likes junk. He started off with dust. Look what he can do with dust. Lord have mercy. He likes junk because he knows his power to transform junk into something and put it in the front seat. Hallelujah. Grace. Grace. Marvelous grace. David said to him, you shall sit with me continually. You have been behaving like an outcast because of your lameness. But you're not an outcast. You belong in the palace. That's why, young woman, stop allowing every guy to use you. You belong in the palace, not in the gutter. Huh? You're not ordinary woman. You're God's child. Young man, stop trying to deflower every flower. You are a prince. Princes don't behave like that. You are a child of God. Keep your head up and walk like a prince. And tell people, be careful how you talk about me. I'm not an ordinary citizen. I'm special. Handmade by God in his image and likeness. Can I tell you about this God? The Bible says in the beginning, when God made all of the universe, he called everything in the beginning into being on the first day. The second day, he mass produced. He said, let there be, and there was. Mass production on the first day. Mass production on the second day. Mass production on the third, the fourth, and the fifth day, and part of the sixth day. Mass produced. He said, let there be, and there was. I have learned that things which are handmade are usually more expensive than things that are mass produced. You don't hear what I'm saying. Things that are handmade. So the benches upon which you sit were mass produced. But if somebody takes his hand and makes it, it's gonna raise the price. That's why after every day it was good. Second day it was good. Third day it was good. Fourth day good. Fifth day good. Six and a five and a half days, it was good. But when man came on the scene, the price went up. It was no longer good. It was very good. Because God handmade. You are no ordinary creature. You are handmade in the image and likeness of God. So what if you can't walk? What if you're lame? What if you can't talk? What if you're too fat? What if you're too skinny? What if your nose big or your head big like mine? What if your eyes black or blue? What if one day he's gonna change it? He's gonna change this mortal into mortality. He's gonna change your lameness. But in the meantime, he will make you sit with him in heavenly places because of his grace. Let me close off quickly with this. Some years ago, a good friend of mine invited me to a concert in which he was participating, gave me a special reserve ticket. Well, just like coming to Jamaica, I decided to dress half semi-casual. We were attending to one of the most prestigious auditoriums. But I said, you know, I'll dress as I felt. When I came to the door, they were well organized. They had all the ushers lined up. And when the woman saw me, she said, come follow me. I felt good, you know. Follow. And it's the blood of Jesus. It's not based on my past. Not based on my stature. It's not based on how I look. It's based on the blood. based on Jesus. It doesn't matter what you say about my past. My ticket speaks about my future. I'm going somewhere. I said I'm going somewhere. Jesus is my ticket. Jesus told me I can come in. Jesus told me I can sit down. How dare you tell me to get up? You are not Jesus. He made me sit, and I will sit with him in heavenly places. In Christ Jesus. That's why I want to invite those of you who want to sit with him to stand to your feet. I've got to stand with him so that I can sit with him. Could somebody say amen in this place? I feel the Spirit is moving in this place. Got a ticket. Got a ticket, Lord. You gave me a ticket. Your heads are bowed, your eyes are closed. Jesus, we all stand here messed up. Somebody dropped us. We go right back to the Garden of Eden and we realize Adam dropped us. He's the one responsible for where we are and why we are where we are. We were dropped because Adam fell down. We sin because Adam fell down. We have committed adultery because Adam fell down. We are thieves because Adam fell down. Fornicators because Adam fell down. Liars because Adam fell down. We are crippled and can't walk like Jesus because Adam fell down. And because Adam fell down, we fell down. But Jesus picked us up. He came to Lodebar. He came to where we were. He understood our condition and says to us, in spite of who dropped you, in spite of where you have been, I have come to pick you up so that you can sit with me in heavenly places. And I do it as David did it to Mephibosheth because of his covenant with Jonathan. God is doing it to us because of his covenant with Jesus. It's not because of us, but because of Jesus that we can sit with him in heavenly places. It might be that somebody here tonight needs to surrender their all to you. Father, I don't want to take this for granted. If there's somebody who's saying, Lord, I want to surrender. I want to be under the banner of your blood. I want to be safe and sound. I want to be able to say I am free. Free from the shackles that bound me. Free from sin. Free from my habits. I want to be free, Lord. You know I've been battling, Lord. I've been battling and fighting. I've been promising you and I've fallen down as quickly as I've promised you, Lord. A new year is coming, Lord, and I still find myself in the same predicament that I was last year. Father, have mercy upon me. Have mercy upon me, Lord. I want to be free. And I know freedom comes when I surrender my all. If you are saying that tonight, I want to pray for you. You want to surrender your all, whether you're upstairs or downstairs, or just take a few moments. I want to ask you to come forward. I'm going to pray for you. I want to surrender my all. I've been fighting against you for too long, Jesus. I want to surrender my all. If you're upstairs or downstairs, saying, Jesus, I want to surrender my all, my all, my all. Whoever you are, I don't know who you are, but you're saying, Lord, I've been struggling, I've been battling. It's a crippled life I've been living. Something has been affecting me, Lord. Something silent. Something private. I want you to release me, Jesus. Break down every barrier. Cast out every foe. Bring every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. So I can walk out here free. I want to surrender, Lord. Help me to surrender. Nobody else knows, Lord, but you know. And that's all that matters. You know. You know, Lord. Praise the Lord. People have come already. People have come already. Lord, I want to surrender. I want to surrender my life so that you will no longer see my life. You will see the blood of your Son on my life. Save me, Jesus, or I shall be lost. I've messed up, Lord. I have messed up. I know I've watched at other people and I've seen all their faults, but I have turned a blind eye. I've turned my eye away from my own faults, my own weaknesses. Or perhaps when I saw my weakness, Lord, I measured myself against somebody else and I said, I'm not that bad. It's not as bad as I thought. But Lord, I realize is I don't have the final say. It's what you say about me that matters. So I want to surrender my all, Lord. If there's somebody else, please come. We want to pray quickly, whether you're upstairs or downstairs. We're giving you these few moments to come forward. Please. Everybody's singing together the chorus, I surrender all. That's our prayer tonight, Lord, to surrender our all to you. Because you have given your all to us. You held nothing back. You came and you give us your all. It's only fair, Lord, that we give you our all. So we present our junk to you. We present our crippled life to you. We present our helplessness to you. We present our hopelessness to you. We present our nothingness to you. We present our habits to you. We present our despicable lifestyle to you. We present our sinful condition to you. And we only ask, Lord, that you will cross your hands one more time and exchange, Lord. Give us your holy life. Give us your pure life. Give us your honorable life. Give us life more abundantly. Take our wages of sin and give us the gift of God, which is eternal life. Let us have the assurance tonight that we can sit with you in heavenly places. We walk out here, Lord, not as outcasts, but as prince and princesses. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. All because of your boundless grace towards men. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for releasing us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, let everybody shout, amen.